Okay, this sermon is entitled, People You Should Not Go Soul Winning With. I'd like to open up with prayer, and then with a few verses. All right, dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners, I ask all this in Jesus' name, amen. Psalm 117 reads, Oh, praise the Lord, all you nations. Praise him, all ye people, for his merciful kindness is great toward us, and the truth of the Lord endureth forever. Praise ye the Lord. Now, I've comprised a list here of different types of people that should not go soul winning, but first I'd like to take a look at a verse in Mark chapter 16, where Jesus himself is commissioning or commanding people to go out and preach. So let's take a look at Mark chapter 16, and look at verse 15, and it reads, And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. Now, in order for this to be accomplished, a person has to be saved. So my number one person on the list that you should refrain from taking with you soul winning is an unsaved devil, a purveyor of a false gospel, somebody who does not believe that salvation is all by grace, or that we're eternally secure in Christ. An unsaved person should not be going soul winning because this gives a mixed message. This will cause a bunch of confusion. And the Bible says in Amos chapter 3, it says, basically, I'm going to paraphrase, how can two people walk together except they be in agreement? So if the people do not agree on the gospel, then you can't partner up with them, not even as a silent partner. The second type of person you should not take soul winning is a skeptic that soul winning actually works, like these stupid unsaved Paul washers out there. They don't believe that if you just go out and preach the gospel to people, that they can get saved. They put an emphasis on follow-up and fruit-bearing and how a person's changed. They don't even care that none of that has anything to do with salvation. Salvation's all by grace, through faith alone in Christ alone. And if a person's skeptical that anyone who simply believes on Jesus Christ has everlasting life, that person should not be going soul winning. That person's going to be nothing but a grumbler, a whiner, and a complainer. They're going to be knocking doors with you thinking that this is just, you know, a waste of time, inefficacious, completely abortive, and those type of people should not be tagging along in soul-winning endeavors. Number three, people that don't know the Bible very well. Okay, if a person cannot navigate through the scriptures and they have a poor understanding of, you know, scriptural geography, they can't go out and witness to people and answer a bunch of, you know, theological or apologetic questions. Okay, if they can't even present the Roman road or just verses in John, then they probably shouldn't be soul winning because we need to know the Bible in order to go out and preach it. Okay, number four, a carnal or worldly minded person has no business going out soul winning because their mind is not right. Turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, it reads in verse 1, And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. Now, I've actually taken people out that were just completely carnally minded. Now, don't get me wrong. Every single person, even believers in Christ, are carnal to some degree. That's why we need to restore our fellowship with God with 1 John 1:9. The Bible exhorts us to walk after the Spirit. Don't walk in the flesh. We need to get into the Word of God and we need to become spiritual. But a carnal-minded person's not going to understand what soul winning is. I've actually taken somebody out one time, and the two words, you know, put together with a hyphen, soul winning or soul winner, he didn't even know what that meant because it's a spiritual concept. So it goes on in verse 2, I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able, for ye are yet carnal, for whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are ye not carnal and walk as men? The carnal-minded person's mind is, you know, in the world. It's not focused on Christ. Turn back to chapter 2. Let's take a look at verse 1, and it reads, And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God, for I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus Christ and him crucified. The reason why the Apostle Paul made it very clear that we should focus on Jesus Christ and be Christocentric is because that's the message we're preaching. We're telling people Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. He was buried and rose again. That's the gospel in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And that a person has to believe on Christ to be saved. Acts 16:31, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. John 3:15, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. John 3:36, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. If you're not focused on Christ, your message is not going to reflect, you know, the gospel. But if you're thinking about worldly things all the time, you're not going to be able to present a clear lucid gospel message. So the last person on my list that we should not take soul winning is somebody who's not necessarily carnal. They could be a church member, or they could be a pastor, or a deacon, or an elder, or whoever, but they're more focused on inviting people to church. They're not focused on the gospel, but they would rather just, you know, try to pack the pews. They want to give you an invite, or a flyer, or a door hanger. They're not interested in actually spending some time asking the most pivotal question there is, and that is, are you 100% sure you'd go to heaven if you died? Okay, these people are not interested in that. All they want to do is just knock your door, give you some type of handout, and move on to the next, and then, you know, I guess tally it up. And these people should not be going soul winning because they're not Christ-minded. They're not interested in getting people saved. So that's all I have. Let me go down my list one more time. Number one, unsaved people cannot be soul winning partners. Skeptics of the gospel cannot be a soul winner. People that don't know their Bible very well, they're not very well versed, carnal-minded people, and people that would rather just give an invite instead of actually, you know, explaining the gospel message. These people are not apt to be soul-winning partners. That's all I have. Let me go ahead and close in prayer. Dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners, I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, this is part two. This sermon is entitled, People You Should Take With You Soul-Winning. I'd like to open up with prayer, and then with a few verses, all right. Dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners, I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 119 reads, Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies, and that seek him with the whole heart. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. Now, obviously a person needs to be saved, or they can't deliver the clear gospel. So I've comprised another list of the types of people that qualify for soul winning. And number one is they need to be King James only. Now, I had on here Independent Fundamental Baptist, but that's not always the case. You don't necessarily have to be in that genre of Christianity to be a soul winner, but you do have to be King James only. You can't use a modern translation and expect to have any power, you know, out on the evangelistic battlefield. So we need to stick with the King James. Number two, people need to be strong or staunch on eternal security. Okay, not just the type of person that passively believes it and will say, yeah, I believe in once saved, always saved. These people need to be strong on that, and they need to put a lot of emphasis on that doctrine whenever they evangelize. Number three, people that actually have a compassion, or they actually care for others. Turn over to Jude, okay, chapter 1. There is only one chapter in Jude. Let's take a look at verse 23, and it reads, It says, And others, save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. Okay, you have to actually want people to be saved from hell. You can't have this lackadaisical attitude that just says, I don't care. God's not going to use an apathetic soul winner. Okay, number four, you have to actually be a follower of Christ. Now, when I say a follower of Christ, I'm not talking about being sequacious, like a bunch of lemmings following the pilot lemming. I'm talking about a true follower, which is a fisher of men. Now, according to the world, or according to false Christianity, a follower of Jesus is a person who's turned from their sins and who obeys the commandments and all this garbage. That's not what it means. Turn over to Mark chapter 1. Let's take a look at verse 15, and it reads, And saying, The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Verse 16, Now as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew his brother casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said unto them, Come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. And straightway they forsook their nets and followed him. Okay, he's using the example of, you know, of a fisherman as a similitude for a soul winner. You're not going after literal sea life fish. Okay, you're going after the lost. You're becoming an angler or a fisher of men. Those are the people that should be soul winners. Number one, King James onlyists, people that are strong on eternal security, people who actually care voraciously, and people that are true followers of Jesus Christ, fishers of men, those that are determined to become soul winners and to actually go out and do it. That's all I have. Let me go ahead and close in prayer. Dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.